very much appreciate the partnership the United States has with the Cote d'Ivoire, working together, of course, on strengthening regional security, but also great appreciation for the Prime Minister's leadership on promoting inclusive democratic growth in the Cote d'Ivoire. We have many challenges before us on our agenda, both bilaterally, regionally, globally. We very much appreciate the strong support that Cote d'Ivoire has given for the principles that unfortunately are being challenged right now by Russia's aggression against Ukraine. So we're working together across all of these areas, but it's very good to have you here. Welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary. First of all, I would like to thank you for being able to find room in your very difficult diplomatic environment, actually dominated by the Ukraine crisis. So thank you very much. I want to come back to our relationship between Cote d'Ivoire and the U.S. and thank you a lot for your support on PEPFAR, fighting against AIDS. It's been more than $1.7 billion in the past 17 years. Also on the MCC, $525 million ongoing project, not only in skills, education, but also on transport project, and in the recent visit of the Congressional Delegation headed by Gordon Weeks, and also the previous ROC operations of training our people at our military academy. It is really helpful. Coming back to Cote d'Ivoire, you talked about our, you know, performances. That's right, for the last 10 years, we've been having from 2012 to 2019, 8% steady growth all along, and it's been going very well. We've been able to double our GDP, to improve also our GDP per capita, and drop poverty by 15 points along all these years. And we've been also able in the past 10 years, but mainly in the past few years, to improve stability, social and political stability in an environment. The last legislative election went really well. This was for the first time in 20 years that all political parties were able to attend. It was a free and fair election, and more recently, I would say last week, we were going to close a 3-month dialogue between the civil society and the political parties, 21 organizations of civil society, and 26 political parties. It went really well. All parties signed, you know, the agreement to say that now, you know, there are issues way beyond our, you know, legal differences, and we're going to walk all along toward peace and stability. Beyond all that, the President set for the next 10 years what we call the Vision 2030. The main issue is for, naturally, to double also the GDP per capita, to create 8 million jobs, to halve poverty by 2030 to 20%, and raise, naturally, life expectancy for 10 years, going to 57, actually, to 67. Naturally, we want to reach this objective, but then we have key challenges that we have to face and to meet, and the first of all of them is to maintain peace and security. Without that, there's no way we can meet these objectives. And one of the major challenges is regional security. And right now, we should say that 3 out of 5 of our neighboring countries are run by the military power, as you know, and the threat of terrorists is right on our door. We have to deal with that, and there's a growing influence of Russia, you know, over the region. We don't think that we want to stay in Mali, and we think that the idea beyond all that goes way beyond just helping the military power to stay. I wrote with me in the statement that I will give a copy to you. I know you certainly know that. It was made by the head of Wagner, and I will cite it. You know, the political process are being renewed, and I am convinced that in the near future, freedom of movement will cover a large part of Africa. A new era of decolonization has just started. It's the time of the colonials. So when I said that, then you know, I should say that definitely we need a strategy, because Cote d'Ivoire is not only a country of it's not. It's just written in French, but I don't really want to have any problem going through that. And it's a very serious comment that is made, and I think we have to take it seriously. So meaning that Cordoba's strategy facing that is twofold. One, it's improve military reaction, response, which is trying to invest in equipment, in training of people to be able, you know, to face the challenges. But the second also has to do with the root cause of these crises, these countries. The youth jobless. We have, you know, 77% of the population is age under 35. Half of the population is age under 25. Mm. And now the biggest stress is you have to find a decent life for these people. They have to be inserted, you know, in a professional environment, because if they are hopeless, then, you know, they're trapped between throwing themselves in the hands of the theorists. Who can give them just a motorbike and $1,000 and just go there, all for the Tahiti Ocean to go, you know, on the illusion to find in Europe, you know, better life. So we have to keep these folks home, not only because the young, but they also are main, you know, manpower. They are really an opportunity for us to be able to train them and to keep them home. So for us, it's one of the key challenges.
I could not agree more, Mr. Prentice. As we get into the substance and the detail, maybe we'll allow our colleagues to.
Thanks, Brett.
Thank you.